What we're going to look at today is to extend this story about stacks and reverse Polish a little bit further. Many of you said, I learned about postfix, reverse Polish, when I had an HP calculator. And in those comments, you've helped to answer some of the questions that other commenters have said. Well, why would you ever use reverse Polish? It does your head in, as the saying goes. Do people really have to think like that? Why do calculator manufacturers and why do the inventors of the PostScript language force it on us? And the answer is very simple. It makes underpowered machinery a lot easier to work well if the machinery makes you do all the hard work of converting infix, which you're much more comfortable with, into reverse Polish. And it doesn't have to do that job. That's why relatively low powered calculators could do so much. And it's why, looking back at my other video about the desktop publishing revolution, at the end of that, I tried to make clear that the PostScript interpreter was running on underpowered hardware. And one of the reasons it could succeed in doing that is, again, it makes you do all the hard work. I think it's interesting in its own right. And it's also interesting when you're trying to delve a little bit more into compilers, interpreters, and computer science general principles. Because under the hood, these kind of issues about stacks and trees are utterly, utterly foundational in the whole of our subject. Today, I want to get in properly into trees and show you how fundamental they are. And an ideal way to do it is to pick up from the end of my stacks and reverse Polish video, which you might want to look at first if you haven't already. Pick up from where we left off and say, what's the fundamental story behind all of this? And the answer is, it's the tree shape. I started off by writing down the arithmetic expression a plus b multiplied by c. If you accept that the multiply must be done first, then the reverse Polish notation would of course be a b c star plus. Remember, RPN, reverse Polish, you can call it postfix also if you want to. Fair enough that somehow you've got to know which are the high priority operators and which are the low priority operators, in other words, which ones get done first. And multiply and divide are of the same precedence as each other. They're high precedence, they get done first. But what happens if you've got a string of stuff, all of which involves exactly the same operator? Do you do it left to right or right to left? Does it matter? Let's take a very, very simple case. 27 plus 9 plus 3. Should it be add 9 to 27 first and then add 3? Or should it be keep the 27 and add it to what you get when you do the 9 plus 3 addition first? This is called left association. This one, of course, is called right associativity or right association. And look, with plus, as ever, there's very little problem. So it doesn't matter at all. Ah, but here comes the one where it massively matters. Well, how about 27 divided by 9 divided by 3? Do you do that and then that, or do you group here? Well, the default is always for left association. You go left to right. Try this on your calculator. You'll find that that is exactly what it does. 27 divided by 9 is 3. 3 divided by 3 actually gives us an integer answer here, a 1. If you did it the other way, of 27 divided by 9 divided by 3, the answer then would be 9. The ordering in which you do things is twofold. First of all, you do your high priority things first, and then if you've got things of equal priority strung out in front of you, you do them left to right. It all comes down to trees. Back to the beginning. A plus B times C. What diagram could I draw that makes it happen correctly. In other words, makes the multiply be done first. And the answer is draw a tree. Draw yourself a tree. As ever, as computer scientists, we all know now, computer scientist trees have their root at the top and the leaves down at the bottom. Here's a leaf, the A operand, and here, down by the multiply, is the B and the C. And you can very easily see why that's the case, particularly if you think about this whole thing as being driven by the operands, not the operators. Imagine that the A is knocking on the door of the plus, saying, go on, add me to something. And the plus is kind of saying, well, I can't, because I've got to know what the right operand is, and I can't know what the right operand is until it reports back to me and says what the intermediate answer from its expression is. So again, think of the B interrupting the multiply operator and saying, we're ready, multiplies together. So the multiply does its work and it then passes its result up the tree to the plus that can finally do the whole thing. So therefore, if that's the shape for that one, what about the shape for this one? The thing that gets done last is the operator at the top of the tree. Look, the different trees. The reason that this gets different reverse Polish, gets a different answer even, in the vast majority of cases here, is that the tree shapes are different. And once you've said, ah, so it's all down to the tree shape I draw. Yes, it is, because here comes even more hidden magic. From the tree, you can work out what the forward Polish and the reverse Polish will be. You don't need to just pluck it out of thin air as I did last time. Start here. You go anti-clockwise. Walk around it anti-clockwise. As I start this walk, I keep looking to my left. If I see an operator, can I write it down? No, you can't. You can't write down an operator until you've seen all of its operands in all their glory. However, as you walk around here, looking to the left all the time, hug the tree shape as closely as you can, look to your left, what do you see? You see the operand A. You can always write down an operand. Come round here, hug the tree all the time, looking to your left, up there, look, you see the operator. Can you write it down yet? No, you can't. You've seen its left operand, but you haven't seen its right operand, so you still can't write it down. Hug the tree, look to your left. Oh, there's a new operator, multiply. Can you write it down? Nope, you haven't seen its operands, so you can't write it down. Hug the tree, keep looking to the left, you see the B. Can you write it down? Yes, you can always write an operand down. Round the corner, still hugging the tree. See the multiply, looking to the left for the second time. Still can't write it down, you've seen one operand, you haven't seen the other, so ignore it for the moment. Look to the left, you see the C, you can write it down. Nearly round the tree now. Come round here, remember always looking to the left. Ah, now you see the star. Can I write it down? Yes, because I've seen both of its operands. Finally, hooray, big tick, up at the top, you look to the left, you see the plus. Can you write it down? Yes, you can, because you've visited all of its operand structure. It's as simple as that. So if you've got the tree, you've got the postfix. You might like to try walking round the tree clockwise and doing the same thing, but by looking to the right all the time. The clockwise traverse gives you forward Polish prefix in reverse. And just to do your head in, do be very clear that forward Polish in reverse is not the same as reverse Polish, which is that. You get the tree. You can derive implicitly or explicitly postfix for use internally in working out your register usage, or if you're in an interpreter, for implementing execution on the stack. Trees lead to reverse Polish quite automatically just by walking around them in the correct way. If you get a choice of either that pair or that pair of thirds, it doesn't matter which, actually.
The system works! Look at that!